Students, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Students, good evening. Are you able to hear me now? Ashwika, Harishankar, Arjun.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, all of you are able to hear me, right? Earlier, we had some issues. Am I correct? Yeah.
No, your audio is bit slow.
Still a bit quicky.
Yes, ma'am. It's not so clear.
Cracking, ma'am. I'm breaking.
Breaking. Just a moment. Please do wait for another 2 minutes, okay? Let me clear it. Now, am I clear to all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so finally we are. Okay, so shall we slowly start with our class?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Right,
okay, so good evening, all of you. So sorry, it's been like 5-6 minutes since we have started with our troubles. So last week, you didn't have any class from my side. So we were discussing about alkenes, an introduction to alkenes in the last class, like last to last week. Am I correct? Do you remember, all of you?
Last week, yeah, last one.
Yeah. Last week, yes, last week on Monday, we had our class. Like, it was not as usual. There was some tangible changes and all because of my son's function and all. So last class we were discussing on alkenes. And what is an alkene? Tarun, you can answer better. Like, I can see you and it's better you answer the definition for alkene. Like, we have been discussing about the definition.
Saturated hydrocarbon.
Saturated?
Hydrocarbon.
Unsaturated. Okay. It's unsaturated because one of the bonds between carbon and carbon, it is a double bond. Means one of them is a sigma bond, another one is a pi bond. Anywhere you are seeing a pi bond, that means it is an unsaturated compound. Okay, anywhere you are seeing a multiple bond, it is an unsaturated compound. Am I correct? Okay, so remember all these things. Unsaturation means wherever there is a multiple bond between two species, two elements or two atoms, then that compound is an unsaturated compound. Okay, so be it double bond, be it triple bond, it is unsaturated. Only if all of the bonds are sigma bonds, then that compound is known as saturated compound. Okay, so I want all of you to turn on your videos, because right from the first of the class with your videos off, it is not comfortable for everyone. It's better we see each other. Okay. So alkenes are unsaturated, double bonded, open chain hydrocarbons, which is having a general formula CnH2n. And our homologous series goes like ethene, propene, butene, pentene, etc. Okay. These things we have discussed already. And geometrical isomers of butene also we have discussed. Am I correct? Like, there is a cis and there is a trans one. Have we discussed that? Or we have to start from that, right?
We have to start with
that. Start with that. So let us take the new board and let us start with it. So when there is a priority group, where there is a priority group, and that priority groups are on the same side, means that compound is cis compound. Wherever the priority groups are on the opposite sides, then it is known as trans compound. That's all. Okay, so let us see. Let us take so many compounds. So let us see each compound and let us discuss with each of it. So you have C triple bond C. When we are discussing about alkenes, we just have to have a C triple bond C. All the other things comes here and then. So you have a C triple bond C. Then you are having H, 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 and H. That is, you are simply taking an ethene. Sorry, ethene. Okay. For an ethylene molecule or ethene molecule, can you say that there is any difference between H1, H2, H3, and H4? Is there any difference? All of them are hydrogen atoms. Okay. So you don't have to specify whether it is a cis compound or a trans compound. You don't have to specify the same. but if this compound is having two chlorine groups on the same side, now we are in trouble. Now we have to say or specify whether it is a cis or a trans compound. Now see, this compound can have two different isomers, like opposite side having chlorine atoms and same side having chlorine atom. Now, which is cis, which is trans? Same side is cis. Opposite side means trans. Got it? Okay.
Yes.
So, when you are saying, learn about trans, don't remember cis. Whenever you are remembering about cis, you might get confused. But trans means you can easily relate it with opposite side. One side to the other, transfer, isn't it? So trans you can remember better, I think so. So you have opposite sides with the same element, then it is known as a trans compound. When the priority groups are on the same side, then it is known as cis. So let us see, when I am saying this priority group, we have to get an idea about what is priority group. So let us see something about propene. You have CH3, C, double bond C, Cl, H, H. What is this compound generally in your language? Cis or trans?
Trans.
Trans, why? You have to explain that too.
Since hydrogen is in the opposite direction.
Both side. Hydrogens are in the opposite side. Or you can better define it as priority groups are, one is methyl group and the other one is chloride group. Priority groups are on the opposite side. Why priority group? Hydrogen is the first element. It is the first element. But carbon is sixth and chlorine is what? 17th element, isn't it? So priority goes for carbon and chlorine. They are on the opposite sides, means it is a trans compound. So what would be its cis cis analog? CH3
hydrogen
on the same side. Okay, chlorine and methyl group on the same side and hydrogens on the same side. This will be cis. Now, have you got a clear idea about what is cis and what is trans?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. All right. So, nobody is having any doubts, I expect. Anybody having any doubts? Have you all noted down all these compounds? Okay, now let us go to the notes. In the slide, I have given two examples about cis-tubutene and trans-tubutene. Let us see how it is. Now, when you are just seeing that cis-tubutene and trans-tubutene, you will get the idea. So you can work out on your own with the notes. Okay. I expect the screen is completed. Can I move to the slide?
Yes, ma'am.
All right.
Yes.
Okay, so geometrical isomers of 2-butene. 2-butene means what? The second and third carbon atom are involving in double bond. Okay, so when we are giving the number wise order, the second carbon atom, we are saying that it is having a double bond. That's why we are calling this compound as 2-butene. Second position having double bond means second carbon atom, from the second carbon atom to the next means third carbon atom, there is a double bond. Okay, it is having two isomers, cis the same sided one and trans the opposite sided one. Okay, so same side having methyl groups means that is cis-butene or cis-2-butene, and the other one is transmute to in or transbutene. Okay. So what is the difference between cis-2-butene and transbutene when it is coming to the physical property? See, can you just simply taking two things, can you just expect or predict which is cis-2-butene and which is transbutene? Is there any way for that? Actually, there is no chemical way for that. Chemical way means what? When you are having a reaction, when you are adding a compound and cis-2-butene is reacting in one way, transbutene is reacting in another way. Means you can identify the difference by chemical method. Okay. But here, in this case, there is no way to identify this compounds chemically. So their physical properties are involved. Cis-2-butene is having a higher boiling point when compared with transbutene, about 3 Kelvin temperature, that's it. But still that difference is sufficient for us to separate these two compounds. Okay, is that clear? The idea is clear, all of you? Have you all completed with the notes? Anybody having any doubts? Yeah, all right.
Ma'am, so generally cis compounds will have more boiling point.
It's not a general idea, Tarun. Sometimes when you are having intramolecular hydrogen bonded compounds, okay, you are going to study it later only. You know what is hydrogen bonding, right? Hydrogen bonding means hydrogen and more electronegative compound is having a partial bonding, okay. If it is happening inside one single compound, that would be more volatile. It will be having the cis identification will be given and it would be having lower boiling point. Okay, that's not a general idea. In this case, this is the way to identify. But definitely, cis, all the cis compounds and all the trans compounds, like analogous cis and trans pair, will have different boiling points, different physical properties. Okay, like cis-2-butene and trans-2-butene have different boiling point. Likewise, cis-pentene and trans-pentene will have different boiling points. Okay, with the difference, you got to find the difference first and then you have to apply it for separation. Is that clear, Tarun?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, not always the boiling point difference is like cis is having greater than trans. In some cases, it is so. Maybe in the case of alkenes, it follows this order. But when it comes to heteroatomic compounds, it is not like that. Okay, there hydrogen bonding factor will have an involvement. Okay, about hydrogen bonding, we are going to study it in next chapter only. So we will see that there. And everybody has, have you completed with the notes? Anybody? Anybody yet to finish? Anybody having any other doubts? Okay. No doubts. Okay. So, next, I'm going to ask you a question. And that question is related to preparation of alkene. Okay. This is a way you prepare alkene. So, let us see how it is. So, this is a JEE. Question, J means question. The reagent needed for converting a triple bonded compound to a trans double bonded compound. How to prepare a trans double bonded compound from its triple bonded predecessor? Okay, that's the question. PH, what I have written PH here is actually phenyl group. Okay. Phenyl group means what? Simply benzene ring, nothing else. Okay. So you have benzene ring at this end and this end, and in between you are having a C triple bond C. Okay. Now you have to give some reagent, and that reagent will convert or should convert this alkyne to a trans alkene. How to do that? Or which is the reagent to be used? And what is the name of the reaction? What is the name of the reagent? See, this is where you will find it a bit difficult to cope up with organic chemistry. So this is my advice. Whenever you are having reactions, named reactions, preparation reactions, reagents, make a list of all of this and try to write down what these reagents are doing. What are these reagents used for? What would be the resulting compound? General idea. Okay. Make a list. Otherwise, you will find it very difficult to cope up with organic chemistry. This is only like tip of an iceberg. Okay. You are yet to see too many confusing compounds, reagents, reactants, named reactions, etc. So let us see how it is going to work with us. Okay. So let me run you the page. Here you are having pH C triple bond C. This is the actual compound. Okay, C triple bond C and the benzene ring. This group, we are going to name it as pH. In short, we don't have to draw it every now and then, isn't it? So pH C triple bond C pH. This compound should be converted to pH C C double bond C pH, then H and H. Now what will happen? Actually, there is a reagent known as Birch reduction reagent, which will enable this compound to become transalkene, and that reaction is known as Birch reduction, and the reagent is lithium in presence of ammonia. For Birch reduction, anywhere when you are seeing the name Birch reduction, there the reagent is lithium in presence of ammonia. Lithium and ammonia is the reagent. And if you got to have cis compound, then your catalyst is known as Lindlar catalyst. Hydrogen in the presence of Lindlar catalyst. In both the reaction, what happens? Okay, in both the reaction, what should be happening? Hydrogen addition across the triple bond should be happening, isn't it? For the triple bond to become double bond, hydrogen addition. See, this hydrogen was not present in this compound. Okay, hydrogen addition across the triple bond on opposite side will be enabled by lithium in the presence of ammonia. Ammonia will release sufficient amount of hydrogen to be added across the triple bond. Okay, is that clear? But when it comes to the cis compound, when you have to produce the cis compound, what to do? You are having cis compound in the sense C double bond C, pH on both side on the same side, both carbon on the same side and hydrogen on both carbon on the same side. What to do? You are going to add hydrogen, but in the presence of palladized carbon. Actually, carbon is the carrier. Carbon means what? Activated charcoal. Okay. This activated charcoal is partially deactivated or poisoned using palladium. That's why this catalyst is known as palladized carbon, means partially deactivated charcoal. It is not activated charcoal. It is partially deactivated charcoal, that is palladized carbon. This palladized charcoal or palladized carbon is known as Lindlar catalyst. Hydrogen
in the presence of Lindlar's catalyst, that is palladized charcoal, will give cis compound as the result. This is cis and this is trans. Now, is the idea clear for all of you? Any doubts from any portion?
No doubts.
No doubts. Kanishka, no. Nina Shri, no doubts. Okay, Tarun.
No Nina doubts, Shri, ma'am.
No doubts. Harishankar?
No doubts,
ma'am. Yashwant?
No Are doubts, ma'am.
No doubts. Yes, okay. Good. So, have you all completed with the notes? Let us go to the slide.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I'm going to the slide so that incomplete notes, you can complete it from the slide, okay? Okay, then when you are reacting this triple bonded compound, the alkyne, with simply hydrogen in the presence of platinum or palladium or nickel. Okay, platinum, palladium or nickel, drastic reduction takes place. Means all the hydrogen will get added to all the pi bonds. All the pi bonds are broken. The compound will get saturated. You will get a saturated compound from the unsaturated one. Clear? Okay. So you don't have to specify whether it is cis or trans because it is saturated. There is no double bond. Okay. Okay, clear? Completed with the notes? All right. So when it comes to this GE or NEET question papers, when if you are thinking that, okay, they will ask a direct question, there is no possible way. Actually, this will be asked in between a sequence of reactions. So you should be able to identify what is happening. Okay. Okay, completed all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Completed, okay.
Yes.
Yes, all right, Tarun. Okay, so let us move to the next one. So how to prepare alkene? Okay, how to prepare alkene from alkyne? So that's what we have just discussed. If you have to get cis alkene, you should use Lindlar catalyst along with hydrogen. Hydrogen in the presence of Lindlar catalyst, which means palladized carbon. Okay, so palladized carbon is partially deactivated charcoal and it is known as Lindlar's catalyst. Okay. And if you have to get transalkane as the product, you should use lithium or sodium in the presence of liquid ammonia. Lithium or sodium means what? Simply first group element, first group metals. Okay. Lithium or sodium in the presence, they will act as a better base. A base in the presence of liquid ammonia. It will give transalkane. Is that clear? Okay. Now, the next question is how to prepare alkene from alkyl halides, which means you have a saturated compound in which nearby carbon atoms, one of them is having at least one hydrogen, and the other one is having at least one halogen. Okay. Two neighboring carbon atoms. One should at least have one hydrogen. At least one hydrogen. The other one should contain at least one halogen. So this is known as alkyl halide. Okay. This is known as alkyl halide. Now what happens? This compound when it is heated with alcoholic KOH, alcoholic base, alcoholic, a strong base in the presence of alcohol. And when it is heated, what will happen? HX, that is hydrogen chloride or hydrogen bromide or hydrogen iodide, will escape, will be eliminated. After elimination, what will happen? Obviously, you are going to get a double bonded compound. Okay. And this type of reaction is known as dehydrohalogenation. Means what? One hydrogen and one halogen is lost. Dehydrohalogenation. Okay, is that clear? Do I need to explain it with the board? Bhavishna, are you able to follow?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Okay, Harini, are you able to follow? Are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Okay. So, completed with the notes, all of you? Anybody having any doubts?
1 minute, ma'am.
All right, all right. Complete with the notes and then tell me. Turn on your videos, all of you. I can't see any one of you, like, apart from Yashwant, Harishankar, Ashvika, nobody's on. Yeah. Can see you, Nina Shri, Tarun. Yeah, good. Okay, Sri Hari Krishna, are you able to follow? Completed with the notes?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, all right. So all of you completed with the notes?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, Yashwant, completed?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Okay, so I'm moving to the next one. So let us see how the order of the reaction is happening. If you are taking an alkyl halide having the halogen iodine, iodine will react better than bromine and bromine will react better than chlorine. That is, iodine is a best leaving group. Bromine is a better leaving group. Chlorine is a, okay, the rate is lower. It is not the best leaving group. It is not a good leaving group. Fluorine doesn't come anywhere into the picture. It won't leave the alkyl compound. Okay. So that's why we are not discussing about fluorine when we are saying about halogen. Okay. Alkyl halide, if you are taking a fluorine containing alkyl halide, it will not give this reaction at all. Okay. So best leaving group is iodine. Next one is bromine. Lowest, the least priority group among the leaving group is chlorine. Okay. And the order of rate of the reaction when you are taking primary, secondary, tertiary alkyl halides. Tertiary alkyl halide will give the best reaction, then secondary, then primary. Okay, clear? So let us see that in detail, because when I am just saying primary, secondary, tertiary, most of you will get confused how primary, secondary, tertiary alkyl halides are going to react. You are having one carbon atom. Okay. Okay. You are having a carbon atom, another carbon atom. This one is having hydrogen. This one is having chlorine. Now you are having CH3, another CH3. What is the status of this particular carbon atom, which I have rounded with red color? And what is the status of the other one? Let us see. Okay. Take blue. Okay. Okay. What is the status of red and what is the status of blue? Which one is tertiary? Remember primary, secondary, and tertiary. Go back to the.
And the one with the two methyl groups is tertiary.
One with the two methyl groups, that is
tertiary.
Tertiary carbon. Okay, this is a tertiary carbon. There, the hydrogen will leave its electron in a better way, and this chlorine can leave very easily. So this reaction will happen at a faster rate. Now, have you understood how the primary, secondary, tertiary factor is coming? Is that understandable?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, got it. So yes, ma'am. Here, this is how primary, secondary, tertiary compounds are working. Now, shall we move to the next one?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. From vicinal dihalides. What does that mean? Vicinal dihalides means what? Okay. So you are having two neighboring carbon atoms and both are having halogen as substituent. Okay. And you are reacting this compound with simply metallic zinc. Okay. You are heating it with metallic zinc. What will happen? This zinc will react with both the halogen and it will take away both the halogen, leaving this compound as an unsaturated compound, which is our desired compound. We will get our alkene. Okay, this is how when you are reacting vicinal dihalides with zinc, this is how you are getting the product. Zinc dihalide will be eliminated. Okay, and this reaction is known as dehalogenation. Remember, the last one is known as dehydrohalogenation, means hydrogen and halogen was leaving. Here in this case, only halogen is leaving. Okay, so it is dehalogenation. Okay. Now, the next way to create alkene is from alcohol. Okay, from alcohol. Alcohol means what? Nearby carbon atoms. One of them will have at least one hydrogen. The other one will have OH group. H and OH. It will leave as water. HOH means what? H2O. It will leave as water, which is known as dehydration. How to make it possible? How dehydration will happen? Okay, when you are out in the sun, you will feel like you are dehydrated, isn't it? You will feel thirsty, you will feel so hot, etc. Okay, what is happening? You are losing water. You are losing so much water. What is the factor for that kind of a feeling? Heat is one important factor, isn't it? So you should heat this alcohol. This compound should be heated with what? Concentrated sulfuric acid. You are heating an alcohol with very concentrated sulfuric acid. Then you are going to get dehydrated compound. Dehydration will happen. Okay, that will create a double bond across the two carbon atoms. Clear? Anybody having any doubts?
No,
this
ma'am.
Alcoholic dehydration
will always appear in one of your JEE, NEET or any competitive exam papers, and that too in between a sequence of reaction. Okay, remember, mark it. Okay, mark this reaction. Whenever, mark it in your heads, whenever you are seeing concentrated sulfuric acid and heat, means it is dehydration. You should find where there is an OH and where there is a hydrogen, and you have to go for this reaction. Definitely. Okay. Clear? Anybody having any doubts?
No, ma'am. No, ma'am.
Okay. Shall we move to the next slide? Everybody completed with the notes? Yeshwan?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Completed. All of you completed. Am I correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, in the next one, let us see how Kolbe's electrolysis will help us to prepare alkene. Alkene can be prepared with the help of Kolbe's electrolysis. How? So you are going to take what? Dipotassium succinate. First of all, you should know what is succinic acid. Okay, only then you can understand what is dipotassium succinate. Now you have this dipotassium succinate and you are going to get it in between two electrodes. Means what? Electrolysis. During electrolysis, carbon dioxide is liberated and some other base compounds are liberated. Hydrogen gas is liberated. Finally, you are getting ethene as the product. Okay, so gas liberated by the electrolysis of dipotassium succinate solution is, this is the question. Okay, have you all written down the question? Okay, gas liberated by the electrolysis of dipotassium succinate solution is, this is the question. Okay, so simply this is the question. They haven't given what is succinic acid. They haven't given what is dipotassium succinate. Okay, you should find that on your own. With practice, you can understand what is dipotassium succinate, etc. These things you can better understand. From practice only, you can get it. Okay, so now let us see how this reaction is taking place. Okay, you have what is succinic acid, by the way? What is oxalic acid? What is acetic acid? What is formalic acid? What is formic acid? You have to get a sequence of acids. Okay. I think I can make a PDF for you, because you should be able to get familiarized with so many acids like these symmetric acids, double bonded acids, etc. That I will make a note for you. Otherwise, for this competitive examination, you won't be able to make it memorable. You cannot memorize it. Okay. So, students, what if I am going to give you an assignment regarding the same? I am going to list out some names of some acids. Why don't you find the structure of those acids? Is that a good idea? Don't you think, like for an assignment, some 10-15 compounds and their structure, their order, etc.? Okay. Is that okay? Let us try. Okay. Anyway, we will. Okay, before that, I will give you a list of compounds and find the structure. Write it down for your own reference. Send it to us. Okay, we will correct it afterwards. We will discuss it in the class. Okay, that's how you are going to get familiarized with self-study of organic chemistry. Okay, let us see what is succinic acid. Succinic acid means C double bond O H. C double bond O H. Okay, now you are going to
add hydrogen atom, CH2, CH2. Okay, this is succinic acid. Okay, succinic acid. This is a diacid. Is this the first diacid? Like in the homologous series, is this the first diacid? No. Actually, this is the first diacid. Try to find out the name. This is the first diacid. Okay. Try to find the name. And now we are going to coming back on succinic acid. And double bond O minus K plus. Now this is potassium salt of acid. Okay, this is how you are going to create salts of acid. Okay, the ionized version. So this is known as dipotassium succinate. Okay, when you are conducting electrolysis with this dipotassium will happen. You are having CH2, double bond CH2, then plus these two entities. Okay, this will leave as CO2. Okay. Now what happens? Hydrogen is liberated. How? When you are conducting electrolysis, you have H2O in the picture, isn't it? H2O means what? HOH. This is also cleavaging. The bond with H and OH is getting cleaved or broken. What happens? This OH will go with K, the potassium. Okay. So 2KOH. Now what is left? Two hydrogen atoms, this hydrogen atom and the other one, isn't it? For two potassium, you should have 2 × HOH cleavage. So this two hydrogen atom, it is liberating as H2 gas. Clear about Kolbe's electrolysis? Any doubts? There should be doubts, I know. Any doubts? Anybody having?
Ask the question.
Okay. Anybody having any other doubts with electrolysis? Okay. Now let us discuss this with dipotassium succinate alone. I am not going to discuss about other things. You are having CH2, C double bond O minus K plus, C double bond O minus K plus. Okay, and you are having the process electrolysis. You are not inserting any reagent. Okay, simply electrolysis. Cleavage happens here, cleavage happens here, 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 and here. Okay, what happens? First cleavage is from this area, so they will undergo bond formation to get double bonded compound. The other cleavage is between this C double bond O and the other oxygen. It is having one negative charge, so it will become CO2, 2 CO2, 2 carbon dioxide. Now this OH and this K plus, OH minus and K plus, it will be liberated as 2KOH. Atoms, atomic hydrogen will be liberated. H2 gas is eliminated. Okay, so now you would be thinking so many electron deficiency or so many electron confusions will be there. See, this is electrolysis. Okay, electricity is passed throughout. Electricity means what? Bank of electrons. So electron balancing will be done side by side. We don't have to bother about it. Clear? Okay, anybody having any doubts? This process of electrolysis, okay, and that is known as Kolbe's electrolysis, Kolbe's process or Kolbe's electrolysis, K-O-L-B-E, Kolbe's electrolysis or Kolbe's process. Clear, all of you? Anybody having any doubts? Tarun?
No.
Harishankar?
No, no doubts, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Okay, Rahul? Okay, so let us go back to the slide and let us see what's next. Reactions given by alkenes. So far, we have created alkene. Now let us see this alkene when it is reacting with some other entities, what will happen? First one is very simple. You are going to break the double bond with hydrogen in the presence of platinum, palladium, and nickel. Okay, so either platinum or palladium or nickel. This hydrogenation, we have seen this reaction earlier where preparation of alkane. Okay. Do you remember?
Yes.
Okay, alkane is prepared in this method. So I have just written this. I'm not going to explain it again. We have done enough explanation in the last class about this preparation of alkane. So first reaction, the hydrogenation reaction, you just have to write it down. That's all. Second reaction is addition of halogen. Means you are taking a halogen and you are simply adding it into alkene, and across the double bond, both the halogen is getting added. What is the use of this reaction or why this reaction we are conducting? First of all, if you are given a compound and you are asked to identify what the compound is, then you will have to run a sequence of qualitative analysis tests. One of the qualitative analysis tests is test for unsaturation. This test for unsaturation is done with bromine water. That is bromine gas mixed in water. Bromine gas mixed in water looks reddish orange color. It looks in a reddish orange color with a very foul smell. Okay, it will give you an absolute headache. Okay, and not just like exaggerating. It's actually, it will give you a headache, and breathing too much bromine is harmful for health, especially among women. Okay. Especially among women, bromine gas inhalation is dangerous. So that's just for your information. So you are getting an unsaturated compound. You are pouring simply some reddish orange bromine water into that alkane and you are shaking it. Okay, what will happen? If that color is disappearing, that means the compound which you had in your hand is an unsaturated compound. You cannot say whether it is alkene or alkyne. Okay. You cannot say whether it is a double bonded or triple bonded compound. But you can just say that definitely it is an unsaturated compound. And if you are told that you can get only an unsaturated aromatic acid, if that condition they are giving, okay, definitely it would be a double bond only, and that acid most probably will be cinnamic acid. Okay, forget about that. Let us focus on what we have at hand. You are having an alkene, you are pouring bromine water into it, or reddish orange bromine gas you are passing through it. It will break the double bond, the pi bond, and each carbon will be added with bromide group. Okay, you are getting vicinal dihalide or vicinal bromoethane or 1,2-dibromoethane. 1,2 dibromoethane. That is the IUPAC name.
Your voice is breaking.
Anybody having the same trouble? Anybody else? Yashwant, can you hear me? Hari Shankar?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Times it breaks.
I can't.
Slightly it breaks, and suddenly it will change normal, ma'am.
Now, are you able to hear me clearly?
Yes,
any breaking issues?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, this is for a test for unsaturation, and you are getting 1,2-dibromoethane, which is vicinal dihalide. Do you need extra explanation with this reaction? Here you can see a CCl4 above the arrow. What is that? Anybody can guess? Okay, that is actually the solvent, okay. For this alkene to get dissolved, you have to take a non-polar solvent, and that non-polar solvent is CCl4. Okay, CCl4 is carbon tetrachloride. Okay, it is a colorless liquid. Okay, to that colorless liquid, you are taking this alkene, and then you are pouring this reddish orange bromine water, it will turn colorless. Means the reaction is taking place. Okay. Anybody having any doubts? Okay. Shweta Kamalam, can you hear me? Siddharth, I can't hear you. I can't hear you, Siddharth. Vishwak, can you hear me? Varun?
Yes,
ma'am. Yes. Okay. Rakesh.
Now it's breaking, ma'am.
Now again it is breaking. Okay. So I think there's something serious trouble. Just a moment. Let me check with my internet connection. Now, is it clear? My voice is clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, whenever again my voice is breaking, just excuse me for another 2 minutes too. Okay. Tell me when that disturbance is happening. Okay. So, this reaction can be given by chloride. Okay. Chlorine can also give this reaction, but iodine will not give this reaction. Iodine is only a better leaving group. It is not a reacting group. Okay. It can leave, but it cannot get added. Okay. So for unsaturation test, bromine is used because of its color. But you can make this dihalide with chlorine also. Okay. The chlorine will get added easily across the double bond. Is this clear? Do you need any extra explanation about these reactions? All of you completed with the notes? Ashvika, are you able to follow?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So far we are going good. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. All right. So let us move to the next one. Addition of hydrogen halide. See, all this time, whatever we are doing the reverse. Okay, earlier we were preparing alkene from hydrogen halide. Now we are preparing hydrogen halide from alkene. Okay, alkyl halide from alkene we are preparing. But is that easy? When you have prepared alkene from alkyl halide, it is simply one reaction. But when it comes to preparation of hydrogen halide from alkene, there you have to go for two types of addition. Okay, one is Markovnikov addition and one is anti-Markovnikov addition. See, it was easy to prepare alkene from alkyl halide, but it is not so easy to prepare your hydrogen halide from alkene. There you have to follow two rules. That rule we are going to discuss here. Okay. So, shall we start with that? Okay. So, hydrogen halide, is Srihari Krishna any trouble? Srihari Krishna, are you able to hear me?
No, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Okay, no problem.
No trouble. All right. So, when you just unmuted your mic, I thought you have something to say. So, hydrogen halides, you can prepare it from hydrogen iodide, which will give the reaction in a fastest way. Then hydrogen bromide, then hydrogen chloride. Okay. Addition of HX, generally hydrogen halide, across symmetrical double bond. You don't have to get confused. It is symmetrical. Any position it is getting added, it is the same, isn't it? Like first carbon atom and second carbon atom, you are having a double bond. Only two carbon atoms are there, like ethene. You are taking ethene. Ethene means one and two in between double bond is there. You are adding hydrogen bromide or hydrogen chloride, hydrogen iodide. Doesn't matter. One of the carbon, hydrogen is added. One of the carbon, bromide is added or halide is added. Simple as that. Okay. Then you are taking 2-butene. 2-butene means what? Symmetric. CH3. CH, double bond CH, single bond CH3. That is, it is symmetric. Right in the middle, you have the double bond. Across the double bond, any position you can add hydrogen and the halide. Both are the same. Second carbon atom hydrogen, third carbon atom bromine, and you are having that compound. Is the same as second position, whatever you have counted as second position, bromide, and the third position hydrogen. Still the compound is same according to IUPAC naming system, isn't it? Okay, only the way you are writing is different. The numbering is the same. IUPAC nomenclature is the same. Okay, priority groups, everything is the same. So you don't have to bother about hydrogen, like addition of hydrogen halide across symmetric double bond. But where you have to bother is unsymmetrical alkene. There you have to follow Markovnikov rule, especially when you are adding hydrogen bromide, HBr addition across unsymmetrical alkene should be followed by, like, you should follow Markovnikov's rule. And what is Markovnikov rule? The reagent, whatever, pens down, all of you turn on your videos. I have to see you, all of you, pens down. All of you turn on your video. Srihari Krishna Ashwaga, I can't see you. Okay. Now listen. You are having hydrogen bromide. What is the negative part of the reagent? Reagent is having the bromide group as the negative part because it is having most electron negativity. Electronegativity is most for bromine when compared with hydrogen. Am I correct? You are having hydrogen bromide. Hydrogen is electropositive, bromine is electronegative. So the negative part is bromide group. Markovnikov's rule says that a negative part of the reagent, of the adduct means what? Whichever is getting added. Hydrogen bromide is getting added. Okay, so that is the adduct. Negative part of the adduct, addendum. Okay, negative part of the addendum will go to that carbon atom having less number of hydrogen. negative part of the addendum will go to that carbon atom having less number of hydrogen. So in an unsymmetrical alkene, inner carbon atom, not the terminal carbon atom, okay, inner carbon atom will have less number of hydrogen. That's obvious. Am I correct? Imagine, just imagine. Okay, inner carbon atom will have less number of hydrogen. Towards that, this bromide will get added, or the negative part will get added. Am I correct, Ashvika? Like inner carbon atom is having less number of hydrogen.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So this is Markovnikov's rule. The negative part of the addendum, that is the reagent. Here, in this case, we are taking hydrogen bromide. This will get attached to that carbon atom which possesses less number of hydrogen atom. This is the rule. Clear? Now, shall we go to the reaction? Sri Hari Krishna, are we ready to move to the reaction?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, according to Markovnikov rule, addition of hydrogen bromide across unsymmetrical alkene is following here. There is a mechanism for this. How this is working out? This we have to discuss detailed way, because this is always a sure question when it comes to any competitive examination. There is no competitive examination without a question from Markovnikov's addition rule. Okay, so let us discuss this in detail. This is the most important, one of the most important reaction from this chapter. One of them is dehydration reaction, because it can come anywhere in any sequence of reaction. Another one is Markovnikov addition and anti-Markovnikov addition. Both are very, very, very important. So whenever they are giving these things, you should be able to sort it out. So now you are having CH3C double bond CH2. That is CH double bond CH2. Okay. And you are having hydrogen H plus and Br minus. I'm just splitting HBr into positive and negative part. Okay. Now you can have two different kind of addition. Negative part will attack that carbon atom having less number of hydrogen. Means what will happen? CH3, CH. Okay. What is actually happening? Actually, to the one of the carbon atom, first this H plus will get added. Okay, bromide ion will stay there. H plus will first get added. So CH, then CH3. In the middle, you are having this positive charge. That is, this double bond has shifted into the terminal carbon atom. This double bond has shifted into the terminal carbon atom, so that this will become negative. Okay, carbanion. To the carbanion, this H plus is getting added. Okay, so what will happen? You have CH3, CH, there you have the plus charge, and then CH3. See, this is a secondary carbocation. Okay, in the other case, what will happen? Other case, when this double bond is shifting to the middle carbon atom, what will happen? There your hydrogen will get attacked. Okay, hydrogen H plus will get attached, and CH2 plus. See, this is a primary carbocation. Which carbocation is stable? Harishankar, primary or secondary? Harishankar, are you there?
Yes, ma'am, I'm there.
Okay, secondary carbon atom is stable, or primary carbon atom is stable, carbocation.
Secondary
is stable. Why? You have to get the reason also, because that's how you are going to remembering the first chapter, some basic concepts. Can you think of the answer, Ashika?
I'm not able to remember that.
All right. Okay. Ashika, are you able to?
Ma'am, I think because of the functional group attached to functional.
No. There is a name for this process. Anybody, can you remember? Anybody? Srihari Krishna, can you just take it from your memory?
No, ma'am.
No, Varun? Have you heard about hyperconjugation?
No.
Hyperconjugation of hydrogen, that is the reason. Okay. So forget it. Not forget it. Do go to the last chapter and try to brush up your memory. That's what I have to tell all of you. This we have discussed in detail in one chapter. Okay. So what happens? This hydrogen, these hydrogens can stabilize this carbocation. So here now the bromide ion is getting added. So the middle carbon atom will get the bromide substituent. Okay. And this is the major product. What is a major product? This is the more amount. This will be the more amount of product. You are getting more amount product from this secondary carbocation. The primary carbocation is produced in a lesser amount. Okay, you are getting less amount of this compound, that is CH3CH2CH2Br. This what? Terminal alkyl halide. Okay, terminal halide halogen substituent. This is the minor product. Clear? Anybody having any doubts? Have you all completed with the notes? Okay, I'm going back to the slide so that you can notes clearly.
Why it is like major and how we are calculating that?
Because one thing is the reactions given by the middle carbon atom, okay, the major product. In this case, 2-bromopropane and the physical property of 1-bromopropane. See, the major product is 2-bromopropane and minor product is 1-bromopropane. Physical property is different. That's how we found out that, this Markovnikov found out that, okay, this reaction is happening in a different way. Okay, now he have done the investigation and he found out that this carbocation stability is the major factor. That is, this hydrogen bromide addition happens in an order like the H plus is getting added first, creating a carbocation. Now, he already know which carbocation is stable. Like, obviously, secondary carbocation is stable than primary carbocation. So, thus, he found out the mechanism, the pathway of the reaction follows like this. That he has found out and he created or he formulated this rule, Markovnikov addition rule. Is your doubt clear? Is that what you asked?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going back to the slide so that you can write down the notes in a clear way because you can get the explanations in a correct way here. Okay, so first the H plus is getting added. Srihari Krishna, notes completed? You are writing it, right?
Right.
Okay, continue. Thank you. Okay, completed all of you with the notes? Ravish is yet to finish, right?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Continue. Yashwant, completed? Samyukta? Kanishka?
Yes, ma'am.
Completed, Kanishka. Okay. Samyukta, what about you? Okay. Shall we continue? Ravish, completed?
Yes, ma'am.
Completed. Okay. Now let us see how you can, if you have to get terminal halide product, what should you do? Okay. Here the major product is the two bromopropane is the major product. What if you need to get one bromopropane? What is the way? How you can get it? Okay. That's when you are going to see about Karasch effect or peroxide effect or Andy-Malkovnikov addition. When you are simply taking HBr, Markovnikov addition is followed. But if you are taking HBr in presence of peroxybenzoic acid or any peroxide, okay, not just this hydrogen peroxide is not enough. Okay, peracetic acid, okay, peroxyacetic acid or peroxybenzoic acid, perbenzoic acid or something like that. Some peroxy group you are using means there you will get a different reaction because this peroxide reaction is initiated by radical mechanism. See, the mechanism is totally different. Okay, this carbocation formation is not there. Only radical formation is there. When radical formation is happening, reaction is very different. And that is known as Karasch effect or peroxide effect. And what happens is Andy-Markovnikov addition. Here you have to take down the notes step by step. You don't have any other choice. Okay, so as I am explaining, pens down. I don't want you to take your pen until I am explaining it. Okay. You don't have to write down from what I am writing on the board. Okay. I will give you time for writing down the notes alone. Okay. So in the
you're not audible.
No, we can't hear you.
Not audible, ma'am.
Okay. So here what happens is in the presence of peroxide, the reaction is happening like what is happening. First step, homolysis. What is homolysis? Homolytic cleavage means first radical formation is happening. Okay. Then that radical is again initiating formation of another radical. Okay. And that radical will radicalize our reagent, which is HBr. Okay. Now you have got the initial radical from the reagent. Okay. From the reagent, the radical from the reagent you have got. Now you are going in for the reaction. Okay. So step one and two, I'm going to explain. Then you can take down the notes of step one and two. Then I will explain the rest of the step. Okay. Because this reaction, we don't have to rush it. It's very important. Okay, you are having some peroxy acid. Okay, peroxy acid means what? Peroxy acid means you are having C6H5C double bond O, 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 again C double bond O, C6H5. Okay, looks like very symmetric, very good, very nice, etc. Okay, but it is actually a bit complicated. Each oxygen, this two oxygen, okay, this one and this one, single bonded oxygen is having two lone pair. Am I correct? Total six. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Correct. Now homolytic cleavage means you are having their own electron is given to themselves. Cleavage is like equal halves. What will happen? C6H5C double bond O. Then this oxygen is oxygen, oxygen, electron, 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 and electron. That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. 6 electrons for each oxygen is our method, isn't it? Element in the element oxygen, how many electrons are there? 6 electrons. Now each oxygen is having 6 electrons. One is bonded, so that electron is not having any trouble. Two others are having at least one pair for company, for keeping it in a company. Okay, two lone pair of electron. See, this one is alone, a bit lonely. That is not stable. So again, radicalization. Again, this will go into radicalization. And what will happen? C6H5, C double bond O, and this will become a radical. See, carbon atom is having 4 electrons. 1, 2, 3. All are bonded. Non-bonded, 1 electron. That is radical. And it is stabilized by this oxygen. Okay, whenever there is this double bonded O, C double bond O, it will stabilize this radical. And there is this phenyl group that will also stabilize this radical. Okay, you will learn about it later, the resonance structure, etc. So here you have made a stable radical, stable benzoyl radical, benzoyl free radical. This benzoyl free radical, one free radical will react with HBr. Okay, now it is the turn for this HBr to undergo homolysis or homolytic cleavage, so that this free radical, this benzoyl free radical will become C double bond O, H, and Br radical. But more stable is another way. What? Carbon monoxide will escape. In this step, carbon monoxide will get escaped. So what will happen? Instead of formation of this benzoyl free radical, more stable C6H5 free radical and C triple bond O, that is carbon monoxide, will escape. The C6H5 free radical in the presence of HBr, this will initiate the formation of C6H6, that is benzene, most stable compound. Okay, and Br free radical. This is the second step. First step is formation of C6H5, and second step is benzene formation with the side byproduct of Br free radical. And this is the important attacking species. This is the attacking species. Let us go to the slide. You can take down the notes. Then we will explain the next step, upcoming steps. Okay. So tell me once you have completed, then we will go to the next one. So in the presence of peroxide, what happens? Radical mechanism is initiated. So a free radical is created, that is phenyl free radical, that is C6H5 free radical is created, that will initiate the homolysis of HBr. So H free radical, which will attach with phenyl free radical and it will go as benzene, you are getting bromine free radical. Completed with the notes, all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Tarun, completed?
Ma'am, 1 minute.
Yeah. Tarun, tell me once you have completed, okay? Neenashree, completed? Shweta Kamalam, completed? Have you... Are you able to understand? Are you able to follow, all of you? Yogeshwar?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, all right. Vishwak? Vishwa? Okay. Tarun, completed?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So the next step is what? Now you have this bromine free radical, isn't it? Now this double bond, that unsaturated one of the double bond, the pi bond, is cleaving among this radical. You are creating a radical with the double bond. Okay. And what happens? Secondary free radical is stable than primary free radical. Okay. So let us see this in detail. Otherwise, you would be confused. Simply with notes, you cannot understand that. Okay. You are having C. You are having CH3, C double bond, CH double bond. CH double bond, CH2. Now, this is undergoing radicalization. Okay. You can get two different products. CH3. You can get only one product. Okay, first of all, you will get only one product, that is CH3, CH dot, CH2 dot. Okay, two radicals. Either of these carbon atoms can get added or attacked with bromine. Okay, so what happens? CH3, CH dot is retained, CH2 Br. Another one is CH3, CH Br, then CH2 dot. Okay, here also CH2. Okay. This is primary free radical. This is secondary free radical. Secondary free radical is stable than primary free radical. So this will be your major product. Okay, as much is clear, I have to clear the board. That's why I'm asking you. As much is clear, anybody having any doubt, ask right now. Okay, you don't have to write the notes. I just want you to get the clear idea. Anybody having any doubts?
No doubts.
So let us go to the next step. So now what will happen? So you are having another. This is propagating reaction, isn't it? This free radical is a propagating reaction. So once you are having this bromine free radical, you might automatically have some other H free radical, hydrogen free radical. Okay, that free radical will get added to this middle one, and that CH2Br is retained. Okay, in the other case, it would be like this CHBr and CH3. Okay, but in this case, this is the minor product and this one is the major product. See, when you are saying this major product, this is about 95%. Okay, and the other one is only about 5%, which can be easily removed with the physical property. Okay, is this clear? Anybody having any doubts? And the way it is propagating, the way it is created, okay, this free radical is created, that from the slide you can take down notes. Okay, I'm going back to the slide, you can take down the notes. Okay, all of you turn on your videos. I just want to see some of you, few of you, because I don't want to get confused whether my network trouble is happening or not. Okay. Yes, Vishwak, I can see you. So students, if you have completed with the notes, whoever have completed, you can leave. I want Sri Hari Krishna to stay back. I want Kanishka to stay back. I want Bhavishna to stay back. Okay, others can leave. Bhavishna, Sri Hari Krishna.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Okay, stay
thank
back.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Shweta.
Thank you.
If you have completed,
could you please show the addition of hydrogen halides notes?
Okay, I think Harishchandra, you better stay back for one more minute. I want everyone to complete with this slide, then we can go back. Okay, is that okay? All right. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Siddharth. You can leave, no problem. If you have any doubts, please stay back. Siddharth, can you hear me? Okay, everyone completed? Vishwa, Ashvika? Vishwak, Varun, yeah, completed. Okay, Varun, is there any doubt? Is there anything I want?
No.
Nothing. Okay, then you can leave. No issues. Okay.
Thank you.
Vishwak, thank you. Vishwak, completed. Any doubts?
Ma'am, can you once again? Ma'am, I have a doubt in Linda's catalyst.
Linda's catalyst. Okay. Let us go back to one by one slide. Okay. Varun, is there anything else?
I'm just checking.
Nothing, all right. Vishwak, Vishwa, both of you are staying back. Okay. Shweta Kamalam, what is your issue?
Ma'am, can you please show me the slide of addition of hydro halides, ma'am?
Okay, hydrogen halides, two of you have asked. Anybody yet to finish with this slide? Bhavishna, completed? All of you completed with this slide?
Ma'am, completed, ma'am.
Completed, okay. So hydrogen halides, I'm showing you first. So that incomplete notes, whoever is having, you can complete it. Is this the one or addition of hydrogen halides?
Our topic starts with addition of HBr.
Yeah, this is the one.
This slide.
Is this the one you need, Shweta? Is this the slide?
Yes.
Yes, from this slide.
This is the slide, okay. Once you are completed, please tell me, okay? Okay, Sri Hari Krishna, first question to you is, can I cut short your name, Sri Hari Krishna? Calling out your full name is sometimes difficult. So, can I call you Sri Hari? That's first yep. question. Okay, so I would better call you Sri Hari. Okay, Sri Hari, what is the strategy you are following when you are studying? That's my question. Like, whenever I'm like seeing you attending the class, I can understand that you are better grasping. But the point is sometimes when you are able to recollect, you are able to recollect. But the problem is when you are explaining it, you are not coming up to that mark, isn't it? Have you found it difficult to like score it? Isn't it? So the thing is, what I have to tell you is, when you are studying, are you going like topic by topic, word by word, likewise? Is that your strategy normally?
Ma'am, no, ma'am.
I think so.
The subject is more tough and not able to understand means I will go by that, like that, ma'am. If the topic is familiar and easy means I'll be looking at the keywords to study.
Exactly. So, Srihari, what I want you to do is with a tough topic. Okay, if you are taking a chapter which is a bit tough for you. Okay, what should you do is simply, if it is containing 50 pages. Okay, a chapter containing 50 pages means you should complete skimming through it. Simply turn the pages, okay? Simply turn the pages while you are looking at it. Simply a glance through each page. This should be completed within 10 minutes. 50 yes. pages of a chapter should be completed. Skimming, the glancing should be done in 10 minutes. Then you will have a better idea about the priority topics. With the tough chapter, in that priority order you start studying, it will become a bit easier. Okay, try this strategy. You will be better able to memorize the concepts. Okay, yeah. Try it. That's what I had to tell you. Now you can leave. If you don't have anything to tell me, you can leave.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, Bhavishna, you are new to the class. That's why I wanted you to stay back. Shweta, completed?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
And you can leave. Harishankar, completed? Is there anything else?
No, ma'am. Completed, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Completed. Okay, thank you. Okay, so Vishwak, what is it?
Linda's Catalyst.
Linda's Catalyst. Not this. This is the one, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Is
yes,
this
ma'am.
The one or the previous question? And then this is one. Okay. Vishwa, what is it? Okay. Kanishka, I just wanted to ask you, what is the strategy of your studies? What is the study pattern you are taking? That's it. Like going through each chapter one by one, or simply like prioritizing the topic and going on that strategy?
Ma'am, chapter one by one, ma'am.
chapter one by one. I just wanted you to continue with practicing questions. Okay, Ganeshka.
Okay, ma'am.
What you should do is when taking a topic and you have learned it, try to collect all the questions related to that topic and answer it alongside.
Okay, ma'am.
You will better be able to score. Okay, that's what I got. When you are responding, the trouble is you are getting the answer, but you don't know how to point it out. Isn't it? Have you ever felt that trouble?
Yes, ma'am.
Like you don't know which is the, to the point answering is not there. You are coming a long way to answer it. Like if you can have a big paragraph to answer the question, but actual answer comes in one single line. Have you felt it? Especially when it is mathematics, you are doing all the steps, only then you are getting the answer.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, that's because of this trouble. Try to practice more questions. Practicing questions will make that thing easy. You can skip some steps because that you know obvious. Okay, and avoid carelessness while doing that. Skipping steps means you should be extremely careful. Okay, just that. That's what I had to tell you.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, you can leave. No issue.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Okay, Vishwak.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I want that Linda's catalyst for that P, that bond, ma'am. P triple bond to double bond. Yes, ma'am.
So, Bhavishna, this is your first class. Are you able to understand what is happening?
Yes. Yes.
All right. Okay. So can I just see you because I haven't seen your face. Yeah. All right. Okay. Which school are you studying?
ABB Matriculation High Secondary School.
ABB.
Yes, ma'am.
That is in Metapalayam Road, right?
Tekkupalayam, ma'am, is from Metapalayam
Road. All right, Metapalayam Road. Okay. So, all right. If you are not able to follow, or if you are not able to understand some part with when it is discussed from the past classes and all,
yes, ma'am.
Just interrupt me and ask me. Okay, that is okay for me. Okay. Collect the videos of previous classes from the center, you can able to understand. And if there is any trouble there, you can ask in the end of the class. You can stay back. No issues.
Okay. Thank you.
Good night. Thank you. Vishwak, completed?
Ma'am, no, ma'am. I just wanted you to explain the process.
Ah, okay. So what happens is when Linda's catalyst is there, actually when you are having this charcoal, okay, activated charcoal, Vishwak, I want your video to be turned on. Because when it is one-to-one, it is better to see your faces, isn't it? So you are having activated charcoal. So activated charcoal is, it will absorb any gas very easily. It can hold the gas very easily, okay. What if it is holding both ethane and your hydrogen all together? It will simply undergo drastic reduction and your product will be the sigma bonded compound, not this double bonded compound. Drastic reduction will happen. So to stop it from going for this drastic reduction, you are going to poison the carbon, charcoal. Charcoal is poisoned with palladium. A little amount of palladium, powdered palladium is added. So this charcoal will not be able to collect all these reactant all together, and now this drastic reduction is happening. Full reduction will not happen. Okay. And the orientation of this ethane will be in such a way that it will give you cis product. Okay. That orientation is made possible because of this poison called palladium. That is Linlar catalyst. Clear?
Ma'am, so this helps in preventing drastic reduction and to form this orientation, ma'am.
Exactly.
Okay. Sure. Ma'am, okay. Ma'am, sometimes I have some feeling that I can't manage the recorded classes sometime, ma'am. If I have some doubts, I can ask you personally, or should I come to the center?
You can see that. No. I am not in the center as of now. As of now, I am at my husband's place. Okay.
Yes.
So you can ask it right away.
Okay. Either you can like stay back at the end of the class. Okay. Sure. You just step in a bit earlier in the beginning of the class, like 5:53, etc. And tell me that you have this kind of doubt. I will be staying back in the class.
Okay.
In the end of the class, I will be. Just inform me prior so that I can manage the class accordingly. And if you can write the questions, like whatever it is, you can make, you just find it out on a sheet of paper.
Yes, ma'am.
And take a photograph, send it to the center. It will be forwarded to me.
Okay.
Okay. And the explanation, I can do it in the end of the class. I can give you face-to-face interaction like what we are doing right now.
Sure.
Okay, so that I can be prepared to answer your doubts too.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, then. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.